Oh my gosh. We're laughing.
Brilliant.
We are good to go. This is brilliant.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's
do
that smile. We're all really excited to be here. I'm Amy Livezey, and I'm here to help celebrate this opening of the show called Storm Trickle Bloom. It's a beautiful show. We're going to take a look at it for all of you to see. We are doing this virtually because of COVID-19. But the Myrna is totally dedicated to being safe with everybody, so please come on down to the Myrna and linger in the gallery and take a look at this work up close. It's really beautiful. And if you come check out a movie or the next soundstage, and also check out the gallery. So we welcome you down. The Myrna is open most days noon to 7, and on the weekends 2 to 7. So feel free to come anytime. Okay, the title of this show, I think this was the brainchild of Leah.
Yes.
Yeah. Leah Cupino. And it's a great representation of the three artists who have contributed their watercolor work to the show. The storm stands for DD Dowden's
chaos
work. All that water in the sky that comes down. The trickle is representative of Leah's beautiful work, which is, she'll tell you all about but water trickling down from glaciers. And then bloom is represented by Janelle DeBray's work, some gorgeous flowers, and also a landscape too. But so what we're gonna do is hand it over to the three artists who are here tonight, and they're gonna walk us through the gallery. And listen, everybody, we're on Instagram and Facebook Live, and we'd love to get your questions. All three of the artists would love to hear what questions you have, and they'll be able to answer them right here, right now. So we're going to start with Dee Dee.
Hello.
Dee Dee Dowden.
Hi. We all came together a little bit by accident, realized we were all watercolor artists, and that we all had different ways of painting, but that really felt like they fit together very well. So my method of painting is, you know, I don't want to get like too blakey on anybody or anything, but you know, but it's pretty personal, and I don't like to put a lot of words on it because it's a very personal experience, and I don't like to transmutate it out into the world where it's no longer available to me. But I love watercolor because it's very immediate. You have to be present in order to do it. There's a little bit of reworking that you can do, but it makes you pay very close attention to where you are, what you're looking at. And then the paint kind of has a life of its own in a way that you have to respect, live with, and work with. You can't go back over it. You can't really redo it. You could create mud on the paper, or you could deteriorate the paper, but mostly you have to just sort of be in tune with it. So that whatever it is in your bubble of time right there that you are trying to, that you've seen, that you want to share that with someone else. And I was reading a book, and there's a German word called Umwelt, and it is about how we each experience, what we experience is just unto ourselves. But if you show somebody what you're experiencing, then there's a chance that they can kind of step into your shoes and see it as you do. So the storm part of this is, I live up on Mount Helena, and I see these clouds daily as they race across the valley. It's a beautiful perspective, and I know that where you live, you see them too. I see Dale's pictures so often that are up there, and there's just, I don't know, it's like there's, in every painting, there's a spark that draws you there and makes you want to do that and capture that. And
if you are lucky enough to get it, you feel kind of like, cool. And if you're not, then it's like, oh, well, next time. So I think each one of us, you know, there's a thing that we saw in nature that drew us and we wanted to paint. And I think that kind of beauty is, it's ubiquitous. It's everywhere, you know. I mean, if you, doesn't matter if you're in Manhattan or Florida or, you know, Arkansas, everybody kind of has the same calendars on their walls, you know. They're beautiful pictures of nature. We all relate to this beauty that we see out there. And in that way, all three of us, too, relate to that beauty. And it's something that captures us, and we can all agree on. We might not be able to agree on who's the most handsome or beautiful, but on, in nature, we agree. You know, you see that, and we know that it's beautiful. So, anyway, so I was painting clouds. I think there's a lot of drama in clouds. We talked about as a group how it was like, maybe this is like the COVID period. I've got the COVID period, you know, where the clouds are building and there's darkness in the sky and the torrent is about to fall. And I like that drama, and that's what I painted, and that's the color palette that I used as I did. So this is a evening storm that was right out my window. Over here is a, most of these are just right out my window, is a sunset that was to the north of me. So I come back. Get on my spot. Stay on my spot. I'm ready to go. Is there anything that you want else you want me to say? Or? I love this building, the Myrna Loy building. There's a lot of things within our gallery here that one could say are challenges for hanging an art show, but they actually, the art kind of, you want me to go over here?
Yeah.
Let's just go over here. Mary? I'm right there.
There we go.
Perfect.
Anyway, so we have all these things, but it's a nice place to hang our art. So anyway, so this one is cloud shadows, which I'm sure everybody in Montana has sat and watched from a distance as the clouds float by and cast shadows on the ground, and they kind of have a life of their own. They're a little bit, there is much what you see reflected on the ground is as much as what you see up in the sky. There's a series of these that I did on a kind of paper called Upo paper, which isn't really paper at all. It's a plastic coated paper. And I think I said to Amy, it's kind of like cheating in watercolor because you can actually lift pigment off of it and you can come back to it. Whereas a lot of these where I might sketch them outside away from my house, when I come home, then I try to add to them and give them a little bit more depth. Watercolor can be pale, and when you get home, you can kind of beef it up a little bit. So that's it. But with these, it's very immediate, you know, and it's just a fun thing to do. It's very fun. I recommend it. I think it's also a great way if you're just starting to watercolor. It's a great way to go. And this is this painting over here. I'm here on my spot.
Perfect.
This is also on Upo paper, and it's out at Canyon Ferry, and it was a storm. As everybody knows who's ever been to Canyon Ferry in a canoe, fears. You don't want that storm, but they move so fast. And then we see these snow bombs all the time that happen out where the whole world is normal except for right where the cloud is bursting. And, you know, that's something that I love. I love that there's that violent kind of just dumping of the weather right there. And
so
it's trying to capture it.
Can I ask you a question, DD?
Yes, Amy.
do you think watercolor is suited for your subject especially? Or do you choose to paint watercolor? Or I guess what drew you to watercolor? Because
yeah.
It seems like these paintings,
yeah.
The watercolor, as we're looking at water, kind of, and it's just, it seems so perfect. But just wondering if there's something about watercolor that...
Watercolor and the painting of water. I mean, I think it's more personal temperament than the media. I painted in oil. I was an engraver and an etcher when I first started off. But I like, just in my own personality, I need something that captures my attention and doesn't let me move away. I'm very hyper about everything. I'm busy all the time. And I like it. Watercolor doesn't. Watercolor is the boss. You're there with it. It won't let you leave. It's got you. And that's great. If you paint in oils, you can come back tomorrow and change it, you know. But on watercolor, you know, you might come back and go, oh, this needs to be a little darker over here, and you can put a little darkness in. But, you know, you have, it's a mindset of being present. And I find that beneficial for me. And not much keeps my attention, but watercolor captures me, and it'll keep me in my seat.
Sure,
Amy.
So, as you were working on these pieces, was there a certain brush that was like your go-to brush because of the subject?
No. I've done a lot of botanical illustration.
Mm-hmm.
So I've done a lot of illustration where it's like triple aught brushes, and you're just like really concentrating and everything. I actually use bigger brushes on these. I use like a 3/4 inch because you've got a sharp side and a fat side and you don't have to change brushes so much. I don't spend a lot of money on brushes. I mean, some of my favorite brushes are just cheap and I have to wrap them in tape and stick their handle back in because they fall apart all the time. And I don't have a favorite brush. I just think, you know, you just grab what's within reach a lot of the time and try to beat the watercolor to the disaster. And that's it. Yeah.
It sounds stressful.
It's not. It's not stressful.
Is that that's the energizing part of it, maybe. Isn't it? Challenge.
It's commanding.
Yeah.
So I think to pay that kind of attention is relaxing. Like anything else that you really like, cooking or meditating or whatever you do, you know, paying attention while it's demanding and commanding is ultimately also relaxing and takes you out of this temporal place and into something that's a little bit more expansive.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I'm going to give it over to Janelle.
Janelle DeBray.
I just want to say it's really awesome to hear other people talk about watercolor because Leah and I are in the background going, So that was very gratifying for me to hear her talk about that. But yes,
second.
This one, however, is very significant for me, is probably a better way to say it. Gosh, we're starting with the in-depth questions first. I have another piece that was created in a two-piece, and this is three separate pieces framed together. It started off as just kind of a water experiment. I wanted to see how, I'm a water nerd. I want to see how water drips from paper to paper to paper, and that's slightly how this one was born. This was also created in a time that was just a time in my life that was pretty rough. And one of the metaphors that I have at that time and now is just this image of a flower coming out of concrete. You know that one little flower that just pushed its way up through concrete and just the resilience of it? Is really encompassed in this for me. And another piece where I just nerded out on how water dries on paper. And as silly as that sounds, it's the most grounding thing I can do for myself. And then when it turns out this way, I just fall in love with it all over again. So Yeah, this piece is very significant for me in that way.
And how did you know when it was finished?
Great question. So I usually do a painting in a day, like DD. I don't necessarily come back. I want to wrap it up that day. And as soon as it's dried, it's kind of dried for me, unless I maybe put a little bit of a pin ink or something on it. I will walk away and come back a few times, just look at it, and walk away again, and come back and just look at it. And as silly as it sounds, I have this little voice in my head that says, like, don't touch it. When it's done, don't touch it. And it's this little, like, fairy. And it's done. It's just this overwhelming peace of, like, oh, it's done. I don't know where that comes from, but it's this simple gratification. And I go, I don't touch it.
It's done.
It's done. It's done.
It's out of your
It's hands. Out of my control. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's
yeah.
Great. How about the one next to it?
So this guy... Yeah, so I love to do a lot of abstract flowers, and I kind of went through a phase where I even said, I don't want to do flowers anymore. Like, I don't know. It was something that I was like, I'm not a flower girl, you know. Well, as soon as I said that, I started producing all these flowers, and I was like, okay. Well, sometimes your creative just takes the better of you, and you kind of have no control over it. So again, that's kind of where the bloom part of this show has happened, and I love it. And flowers for me are a great way to experiment with water. I mean, one of the reasons I love watercolor is because the textures that you can do are just endless. And for me, flowers are a good way to embrace those textures all in one paper.
I love that description of bloom. It's not just a flower blooming because it's been watered, but it's the bloom of your creative
on the paper.
Pieces. I mean,
yeah.
The way flowers became a subject that you could express yourself through.
Sure.
Its own kind of bloom.
Yeah. Yeah, even in a way, I mean, just the bloom of the pigment in the water itself blooming on the paper. I mean, I come back to, I'm such a water nerd. I want to figure out how it dries that way and how it textures that way. And ultimately, flowers were the best way for me to experiment in that way. So, yeah. I'll show you one other piece if you want to. We'll go down this way. And this answers your question. I don't know where to see.
Let's come back a little bit. A little bit more. Perfect.
Perfect? Yeah?
I'm going to move this
one. Okay. Well, I'll talk about this piece while you're moving that. Amy asked earlier what my favorite piece of this collection was. And it is this piece here. The reason why is more because of the environment in which I painted in. I mean, I love the colors of this piece. I really used this bloom effect of, I really wanted to just have the water behave in its most natural element, see what happened, and then add it to it without manipulating it too much. And that's how this was created. This is my favorite piece because of the environment I created in. It was summer of 2019, and I was on a back patio, blue sky, Montana blue sky, the fluffy clouds. I had, you know, jeans and no shoes on, like a classic summer Saturday. And I had this, I had many different paper easels up, and I'm a messy painter, pretty messy. I like flinging paint. Paint goes everywhere. So I had a lot of cloth on the floor, and there's a moment, I think, for some of us, or for me, when I paint, I don't know what day it is, right? I don't know what time it is. I don't know where I'm at. And those are the best times where I can really ground in the water, but also zone out when it comes to everything else. And that, those are almost the paintings I remember more because of the environment that I was in when I did it. So this reminds me of just a sunny day, bare feet, you know, blue sky, peace.
Yeah. Were you listening, do you like to listen to music when you're painting?
Yeah, I think I need a little bit of noise, whatever that is. And I don't have one thing. I think last year it was a series of podcasts. The year before that, I was all about classical. I like to do some R&B every now and then. I mean, I am all over the place. It really depends on the mood that I'm in. Well, and I like to sing, paint next to live country music as well. So I've done that as well. So
turned out to be quite a good event.
Yeah, yeah. So I've done that in several cities. I love painting next to live music. Just again, that energy and the environment in which that painting has been created in is half the love of it. So anything that gives me additional creative energy, I'm down for.
So having people around can help with that.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's a little nerve-wracking, right? But I think for me, that balances the grounding that the water provides me as well, right? Like I can kind of tune out the people in a way and just zone in on what's going on. And don't get me wrong, that's taken some time to do, but it's extremely fun. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. That's so great.
Thanks.
How about the next one?
So this actually has a pretty emotional significance as well. Again, this was made during the time.
I just have to straighten this just so.
Oh, thanks, Dee Dee. I appreciate you. This, I was talking about my phase earlier of like, I'm not gonna be a flower artist. Well, and then this happened. And I was like, gosh, I really like doing these. I like seeing how the water naturally kind of creates a bloom, like we were talking earlier, and then just adding some small details to make it come in focus without being over detailed. Because, you know, with watercolor, you just have to work with what you got. You can't erase. So I really like this guy. I called him my incredible Hulk flowers. I was in a green phase. I don't know. I know it's silly, but it was something deep down inside of me, and I was like, oh, these are incredible Hulk flowers. It stuck. As silly as it is, it stuck.
We're getting some nice comments, just so you know.
Oh, thank you.
People are enjoying hearing everybody talk about their
effects. Awesome. Well, can I pass it on to the next?
Yes. Leah.
Sweet. And then all of a sudden I realized there was places that I would love to paint that I've never been to. I've been to a few glaciers, just to like validate me a little bit, but I now have a very long list of glaciers I'd like to visit. When it comes to the glaciers themselves, I find a symbolic depth to them because of the way that they are celebrated, but also are very quickly leaving us. I think about the sacrifice of giving themselves to everything below them. And with that depth and that heavy idea, I celebrate them in wild color and bold strokes and lots of marks. And I think it's something, if I talk about it too much more, I'm gonna like start tearing up. It's something that's very deeply personal to myself. And I often work very abstractly because I don't always like to express myself in words. And I feel like there are those spaces in between where words don't fit. However, in order for me to get there adequately, I also need to tighten up again and do some realistic work. So in this exploration of my work, you will find very tight, very representational, realistic, 3D-like work. And then you will also find work that is far more loose, far more interpretive, and also seeking to have that 3D. The painting here on my right is Grinnell Glacier. It's one of the most visited glaciers in Glacier National Park. If you take a hike here, it's a little bit under 6 miles. And you kind of arrive in this little corner and you look out towards the glacier over here. There's a large glacial lake below it. Just above is, I believe, Salamander Glacier. And then the photo is taken, I think, if I had to guess, from Gem Glacier, which is a little tiny one just up above Grinnell. This way, that way. Welcome to the water fountain. I didn't do this one. This one just a little bit. This is kind of a fun one. I like to say just a little bit about this one. So often I source from older photographs, but I also like to source from topographical maps. So I really do hop on Google Maps and I try to find satellite imagery. One of the really fun things I did specifically in this painting is I used Google 3D. And so I got in there and found an angle which I found the most fascinating to paint. And this little glacier is called Hidden Glacier. And the peak up there is, I believe, Sky Pilot Point or something very close to that. That's mostly what I want to say about that one, but it also encompasses this crazy, almost like cadmium yellow hue that sits really close and dear to my heart, along with one of my favorite artists, Joan Mitchell, who uses it quite a bit in her work as well. But that orange and turquoise combination has always found its way back to my work over and over again.
Yeah, we were just going to ask you about that color. It's really great.
Yeah, there's probably an Indian yellow in there, and then some ochre. I'm trying to bring up some more watercolor terms in my mind there. But they get blended a bit with some Payne's gray, and just kind of
Payne's gray.
Payne's is everybody's favorite. Oh, something else about these more tightly woven works is that I do add ink at the end. And so with that addition, my energetic mark making, which I can never leave behind, is allowed to enter into the pieces.
So I was curious about that, whether or not you did a sketchy drawing first and filled it in, or if it was the second part of it. So you're saying it's like the second layer.
I'd like to sandwich it like an Oreo cookie.
All right.
So I have very light marks at the very beginning, unless I really want them to be there from start to finish.
We're getting a lot of beautiful comments on your work, Leah.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
What provoked you to make such small pieces, or did you start with small pieces in photography? I love this string concept that you're doing right now. I love it.
This is how I view my small pieces in my studio and how I kind of take them in and library catalog them in a way and keep them with me at the same time instead of flipping through a sketchbook. The smallness of it has to do more with my turning 40 the next week.
Happy birthday!
Thank you. And the idea that energy to me and where I spend my time and the idea of this goes a little bit deeper too into where the glaciers fit. But the idea of exploitation and the idea of now I get to pick where my energy is spent thanks to COVID. Nothing in my body wanted to go big. Nothing about that energy felt like it could come out and be that large in the world. And so it has a lot to do with my processing on a smaller, more intimate level. That 12 by 12 is topographical. So I'm kind of playing a lot with how I get space to show up when there's really, really bright, vivid, highly saturated values and hues, and then also working with a lot of those more subdued neutral tones that sit more in the muddy gray areas and all the little subtleties in between. So I'm kind of playing with the idea of like, how do I show space with a topographical map? And so that's something that I don't have to battle with as much when I'm dealing with something that's a little bit more realistic in a landscape. That's already been scripted in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
So these three little pieces go together. They're a really sweet little glacier. The name escapes me right now, but there's a sweet little, here we go. It's Grant Glacier. Grant Glacier.
Yeah.
They're just kind of different color schemes, and then also different times that this very same glacier has been photographed across many decades. The one over here, I really, it's actually not for sale. Sorry, Myrna.
No.
I know. this one has a little bit more to do with the idea that the glaciers give birth to a valley. I'm still working with that. You might see it in a really large version, maybe a few different times in the future.
Whether it's this or just how you've always painted, when you're in the zone, do you have influences or certain things that you, where you mind those things that you think about while you're painting?
Oh, thank you. I mentioned to Amy earlier that I wanted to include a Philip Guisson quote because this is so true, and it's kind of what DeeDee and Janelle also touched on, and I think a lot of artists always touch on when they're creating, not just visual artists, but when you enter your studio, you bring with you, and I'm paraphrasing here, you bring with you your friends, your family, your teachers, the artists that you've watched, and all your influences, and slowly they leave the room. And then when you're really painting or really creating and in that zone, even you leave the room.
Mm-hmm. Well said.
Yeah, great. Love that quote.
Well, and as the Myrna Loy, I want to thank the artists for putting so much work and time and soul and beauty into this exhibit. It's really a beautiful show, and I want everybody to come down and look at it at the Myrna Loy. We're open at noon through the movie hour, Monday through Saturday. And this is really beautiful work, worthy of coming to see in person. And thank you all.
You're so welcome.
You're here.
You're here.
All right, guys. I'm in it.
Okay.
Good job, everybody.
Thanks for joining us.